Hello friends, I'm Srishti and today I have brought 5 questions of finance for you. So today's topics are related to the current affairs as well as the topics related to financial management. Do pay the attention till the end of this video because today we are going to discuss the current news related to the corporate rate tax cut and also some really important topics of FM wherein we are going to discuss some important concepts which is really important from the examination point of view. If you haven't subscribed to our channel yet, then do subscribe because to have regular updates related to my videos and other videos which may be beneficial for your examinations. So starting with the first question for today, the first question says, human capital contract is a new type of financial product that allows for the provision of funds to an individual through an equity-like arrangement. What are the drawbacks of HCC, that is human capital contract, when compared to the traditional student loans? If you do not know the meaning of human capital contract, then don't worry because today we are going to discuss what HCCs are and we are going to compare it with the traditional student loans. You must know about the student loans. And there are some drawbacks also attached to this HCC that we are going to discuss to answer this question. So let's have a look to the next slide. So HCC, that is human capital contract, it is a finance product where the provider of the funds receives a portion of the individual's future income for some specified period of time when initially he gives the funds to that individual or that student through an equity-like arrangement. For example, if you are a student and you want to take HCC and there are some providers of this HCC, so they'll invest in you based upon your future income. So if you get supposedly 10 lakhs as HCC, then your payout in the future will not be dependent upon this 10 lakhs. Rather, your payout will depend upon the income that you will earn in the future. For example, if you earn 1 lakh per month as your income and it is pre-specified that 10% of your future income will be regarded as a payout for this HCC, then every month 10% of your 1 lakh income will be considered as the payout. If you earn 50,000, then maybe 10% of 50,000 will be considered as your payout. So can you see that if we compare it with a traditional loan wherein you have to pay out the loan at some pre-specified interest rate along with the principal amount no matter you have the money or not. And because of this compulsion, there were increasing NPAs because students usually take the loans and then they are unable to repay back the loans. And that is the reason NPAs were on a rise. But now with HCC, there will be variable payouts in HCC based upon your future income for some specified period of time and thereby NPAs will fall. Now, so far so good, we have discussed how HCC is better over the traditional loan and what is the mechanism for taking HCCs. But then what are the problems associated with HCC? Let's have a discussion on it. Okay, so first the problem is of the problem of adverse selection. Now, what does this mean? As I have already told you, that the HCC's payout will be dependent upon your future income. So students who generally opt for such programs, they are generally those who expect to pursue low income careers and are least likely to be able to repay their traditional loans if they would have taken it. So the providers of these funds, that is HCC, are not in a favorable position because only those students who have low income careers will opt for this. That is, student earning 50,000 per month will go to take HCC, whereas student earning 1 lakh will not opt for HCC. Then we have the problem of moral hazard, which means human capital contracts like income taxes can contribute to moral hazard by discouraging the borrowers from maximizing their income and encouraging them instead to focus on non-wage based forms of compensation such as more enjoyable work, better benefits or lighter schedules. So the students who have opted for HCC will not take an extra effort to increase their salaries. They would rather go for more enjoyable work with better benefits and lighter schedules. So these are the problems which are associated with HCC. So let's move back to the question. So as we have discussed, the problem of adverse selection and problem of moral hazards are the two main drawbacks of HCC. Let's have a look here also the problem of frauds by the students. So here the student doesn't fraud because it is mentioned in the contract that at a pre-specified rate for a pre-specified time, a certain portion of the future income of the student will be regarded as the payout. And if the student has started earning, then he has to pay it. So there are no actual frauds by the students. Then we have problem of fraud by the capital providers. So this is also not the drawback of HCC. So the two main drawbacks are 1 and 3, that is problem of adverse selection and moral hazard. Now moving on to the next question for today. Which of the following costs are not considered while calculation of the cash flows for financial project viability? So in financial management, while analyzing a project, there are some costs that are included to analyze the viability, and whereas there are some costs which are not included. So out of these four options, only one cost is there which is not included for the calculation of cash flows for financial project viability. And you have to tell me which is that cost. But before that, let's have a brief discussion about what these four costs are. First is the installment cost, that is the initial cash outflow, which includes the total cost of the project in order to bring it in workable conditions. For example, if in a factory you have purchased a machinery, then its installation cost or the transportation cost may be considered as this initial cash outflow and which have to be considered while the calculation of cash flows. The second is the sunk cost. So they are the costs that have already been incurred in the past and they have nothing to do now or in the future. They cannot affect anything. So we'll have a discussion on the sunk cost and opportunity cost once we have done with the definitions that I have mentioned here. The next is the opportunity cost. The next best thing foregone, that is, it is an implied cost. The next is the salvage value. It is the estimated resale value of an asset at the end of its useful life. For example, you have purchased the machinery with a 5 years life. Then after the 5 years, the realizable value of this machinery will be regarded as the salvage value. And while calculating the cash flows, while adding all the costs, you subtract the salvage value because it is the amount that you are going to get after the end of the useful life of that machinery. Now, let's have a look at sunk cost and the opportunity cost through an example. So, let's take an example that there is an idle plot of land. So, if the office building is to be constructed on this idle plot of land, then the cost of land is a sunk cost and you will not consider this cost while calculating the cash flows for the financial viability of the project. So, therefore, it has to be ignored. But if the firm did not use the plot for building purpose, it could sell it or use it for some other project, and thus the plot of land has an opportunity cost because it could have another use. So the firm in this case should include the market value of the land as the part of the initial cost of the project, and the amount originally paid for acquiring the plot is a sunk cost and is irrelevant. So I hope that I have made myself clear that when this plot is regarded as the opportunity cost, then the market value of this land will be considered as the opportunity cost and may be included as part of initial cost. Whereas the amount which is actually paid to purchase this plot is a sunk cost and therefore that is irrelevant. So I have discussed two cases with you. One, if it is a sunk cost, and another if it is an opportunity cost. So let's move back to the question to answer it. The question was to identify that cost which is not considered while calculation of cash flows or financial project viability. So sunk costs are never considered for the calculation of cash flows and they are ignored. Now moving on to the next question, hoping that you have understood the concept of sunk cost and opportunity cost because these are the only costs in which students usually get confused. The next is, which among the following approach incorporates the project risk in different degrees for different years. So out of these four options, there is one such approach which incorporates the risk of the project in different degrees for different years. To answer this question, you must know the mechanism of risk adjusted discount rate, which is also known as RADR, certainty equivalent, internal rate of return, and capital asset pricing model. So let's discuss all these in brief, and then we'll have a brief discussion on these two topics. Okay, so IRR is a discounted cash flow technique of evaluation of capital budgeting proposals, and it is defined as a discount rate which produces zero NPV. That is, the IRR is a discount rate which will equate the present value of cash inflows with the present value of cash outflows. So the rate at which this is equated, that rate is IRR. So as you can see that this rate does not change year by year, rather one rate is there of IRR, and the cash inflows and cash outflows are there for several years, and based on those cash inflows and outflows, this rate is determined. So our option IRR is not the answer, because we have to find that approach which incorporates the risk in different degrees for different years. That is, every year the rate of risk or the degree is changed. The next we are going to discuss is the capital asset pricing model. So capital asset pricing model is used for pricing the risky securities and generating expected return for the assets given the risk of those assets and cost of capital. So this model is used to price the securities, and therefore this is also not our answer, and we can easily eliminate this option also. Now we will discuss what is RADR and certainty equivalent in the next slide. So first let's see what RADR is. This approach is profit oriented and it considers the time value of money and explicitly incorporates the risk involved in the project by making the discount rate as a function of the proposals or the project risk. So only at one time there is an adjustment for risk and time. And if we see certainty equivalent, then this approach attempts at adjusting the future cash flows instead of adjusting the discount rates. The expected future cash flows in this case, which are taken as risky and uncertain, are converted into certainty cash flows. So let's compare these techniques, RADR versus CE approach. So the RADR incorporates the risk by increasing the discount rate. That is, it deals with denominator of the NPV formula. I hope that you remember it. The CE approach, on the other hand, it incorporates the risk by deflating the expected cash flows to CE cash flows, that is certainty equivalent cash flows, and so it deals with the numerator of the NPV formula. So this deals with the numerator of the NPV formula, whereas this deals with the denominator of the NPV formula, and both have different measures to incorporate the risk. Here the rate of return is increased to assume additional risk, whereas here the cash flows are deflated. One more important thing is that in case of risk adjusted discounted rate, there is an implied assumption that the risk of the proposal increases at a constant rate over the life of the project. That is, this R remains constant. On the other hand, the CE approach incorporates different degrees of risk involved for different years. For example, there are cash flows for 4 years. Suppose 50,000, 60,000, 70,000 and 80,000. So based on the riskiness of each of the following cash flows, certainty equivalent is calculated and the following cash flows will be deflated as per the risk involved. For example, this is deflated to 40, this is deflated to 50, 60 and 70 based on the risk. So as you can see, a different degree of risk for different years have been considered in the certainty equivalent approach, and therefore we have got our answer for the question. So the answer to this question is option B, that is certainty equivalent. I hope that you have understood risk adjusted discount rate and certainty equivalent in detail and in brief as to how these both work. Now let's move on to the next question for today. This question deals with the recent announcements made by the finance minister to stimulate the economy of India. So you have to identify that which of the following statements are correct. As a finance student, you must know every announcement which are important to stimulate the economy of India. So before reading on every statements, let's first discuss what are the six key decisions made by Nirmala Sitharaman to stimulate the economy of India in the next slide. The first is cut in the corporate rate tax. So earlier it was 30% and the effective tax rate, that is inclusive of cess and surcharge, it was 30.9% to 34.61%. Now this has been reduced to 22% and now the effective tax rate comes out to be 25.17%. So this was the first announcement. The second relates to the low tax regime for new manufacturing. So to boost manufacturing and Make in India initiative, government has slashed the corporate tax rate to 15% from the earlier 25% for domestic companies incorporated. Now notice the date here. Domestic companies which are incorporated on or after 1st October 2019, making fresh investment in manufacturing. Also notice that the option to pay the income tax at the rate of 15% that is available to companies which do not avail any exemption or incentive and they commence their production on or before 31st March 2023. Now one fact here that the 15% rate is among the lowest in South and Southeast Asia, and because of the China-US tariff war, which has led many MNCs exiting China, now India will be a favorable landmark for those companies to invest in. The third is MAT relief for companies staying in the current regime. So 15% MAT is there as against the earlier 18.5%. The next is relief on surcharge on FPIs. So FPIs have been provided the relief from the tax surcharge for transactions in all the asset classes, be it equities, be it mutual funds, be it debt or derivatives. But wealthy investors who are residents of India and family trust, on the other hand, will have to continue paying higher surcharge on gains made for derivative and bond market trades. The next is no tax on buybacks announced before the budget. So to provide relief to listed companies that had announced share buyback before 5th July 2019, the government exempted such companies from the buyback tax. Last is CSR funds made available for incubators, universities and research bodies. So the government has also made government funded incubators eligible for the 2% CSR spend, a key demand from the startup community. So broadly, these are the six key decisions which have been announced, and we have discussed all the six in brief. But because of these cuts in the corporate tax rate and MAT relief and all these, there is a 1.45 lakh crore foregone from the government's revenue, and there arises the fiscal worries for the government. Now let's move back to the question. So let's read the statements one by one. First is corporate tax rate reduced from 30% to 22%. This is correct. MAT reduced from 18.5% to 10%. This is incorrect because it is not 10%, it is 15%. The next is low tax regime for new manufacturers to 15% from 25% for all domestic companies incorporated on or after 1st December 2019. So this date is 1st October 2019 and not 1st December. So this statement is also incorrect. Fourth statement says FPIs have been provided relief from the tax surcharge for transactions in all asset classes. So this is correct. And the last one, which talks about the CSR for incubators, this is also correct. So the correct statements are 1, 4 and 5, and therefore our answer is option B. Now, moving on to the next question and the last question for today. What will be the net present value of a project whose cash flows are sufficient to repay the capital invested for rate of return? So notice the word sufficient here, which means that present value of the cash outflows is equals to the present value of cash inflows. That is, the cash flows are just sufficient to repay the capital invested for the rate of return. That is, they are equal. And when cash outflows and cash inflows are equal, NPV is zero. So our answer is option B, zero. When the present value of cash inflows is greater than present value of cash outflows, NPV is positive, and this is where the project is considered, and it is considered as a good project. The third is that present value of cash inflows is less than the present value of cash outflows, so there the NPV is negative and the project is not considered. When this NPV is zero, the project is indifferent and it depends upon the company to take up the project or not. So the answer to this question is option B, that is zero. So with this, we have completed our 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you have liked this session and you find this session as an informative one. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates related to finance videos. Thank you for watching the video.